Hello everyone and welcome to Your Stories 3rd Annual MSME Summit 2021. I am Bhavya Kaushal, your host and moderator for the day. Just like the last two editions, this year we have founders of top SMBs, Indian businesses, thought leaders, as well as industry and government stakeholders from across the country joining us through the 10-day event in virtual one-on-one conversations, panel discussions, and much more. Before beginning today's session, I'd like to give a special shout out to Lenovo and Intel, our title sponsors for Indian MSME Summit 2021, and our co-sponsors AWS and TransUnion Sybil. COVID-19 has made everyone realize that businesses cannot go on without leveraging technology. In fact, it has accelerated the pace at which businesses, especially SMBs, are adopting technology. This also means that India is ushering a new wave of industrial revolution that will be defined by the use of technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, automation, advanced engineering, and much more. Factory automation market in India is exhibiting significant growth owing to the growing need for a reliable and more cost-effective method of production, which results in minimization of waste. In today's session, we will talk about how the rise in automation in the manufacturing sector will pave the way for an Atmanirbhar Bharat. With this, I would like to introduce you all to the panelists for today. First, we have Kanishka Arumugam. He's the co-CEO of Eki. Second, we have Uday Narang. He's the chairman of Anglian Omega Group and Omega Seki Mobility. And finally, we have Pankaj Podar. He is the CEO of Cosmo Films. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
Kanishka, I would like to start with you and shoot my first question to you. So you, over the years, you've seen your traditional pump manufacturing business transform into a water technology company. I want to know from you that how this technology has transformed your business for the better, and why do you think technology is so important in today's time for businesses to include?
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everybody. Thank you, Bhavya, for inviting me over. So I am part of this company called Eki Pumps. So we are primarily manufacturing water pumps. So we are transforming our company into a water technology company. That's our aspiration. And it's not a fully done job. It's always a work in progress. So we started this journey because when I came back from England after working for the world's largest producer of pumps and systems, I joined the business 5 years ago and I visited a lot of customers and our channel partners. The customer really, the end customer today really wants only the water. So he does not care about the pump or the pipe or the cable or whatever solution. So he wants a complete integrated water solutions. And I feel the industry is highly fragmented and there's a lot of scope for improvement there. So in this process, we use a lot of digital tools. We use other types of water technologies and we're trying to become an integrated water technology company.
Right. Would you like to add how technology has made things so much better and why it is so important in today's time?
I think all these technologies such as, artificial intelligence, automation, machine learning, all this are only tools to enhance the customer. So, you know, it is a continuously, if you look like, 10 years ago, there was always like a quality movement in the manufacturing space. So if you look, there are very few people who are going to manage robots. And as times goes on, even in our shop floors, we'll have to train people differently and think about the whole education and labor policy differently for our industry. So coming to the, our manufacturing plant, we believe designing the manufacturing is as important as designing the product itself. And in the product end, the customer wants more of solutions. So on the customer facing, we are looking at giving water solutions. And on our manufacturing area, we're looking at designing the manufacturing efficient, so it is giving least quality issues and high productivity.
Right. Thank you. Moving on, Uday and Pankaj, because you know you both have been in the ecosystem for so long, I want to know that how has the pandemic really sped up the process of companies adopting automation in India?
We're all soldiers, obviously. You know, we've been in the game a long time. So I think obviously, you know, the pandemic has clearly shown that, you know, automation was already on the way, but it has accelerated. You know, we at Anglian Omega are running businesses in steel, in infrastructure. Obviously, our biggest venture right now is OSM, which is the Omega Seki Mobility. We are using automation all across our industry and all across our companies. And what has happened is post-COVID, you are seeing an immense amount of automation going on. There was obviously concern with labor. There were concerns with efficiency. There was concern with supplies. We are using this. We have been using the last 16, 17 months to continuously automate all of our systems in all across our companies. Here in every area, in our steel business, in our infrastructure business, even in OSM. So I think what the pandemic has taught us is automation is the future. It was already on the process, but what we believe is that the COVID, post-COVID world, the automation is going to take a major role in productivity, in efficiency, and in the systems that we are building.
So thanks for this opportunity. See, I will say that customers and corporations, they look for convenience. You know, so they always value, especially in a country like India, both customers and corporations look value for money, whether the automation is giving them the right convenience and the right value for money. And what has really happened in last 10, 15 years is that the technology has got cheaper. And, you know, we see so many startups coming, giving newer solutions to the customers, consumers, and corporations. And therefore, they're adopting this technology really fast. I would say that this has two parts of it. One is the hardware part of it, and the second is the software part of it. And we see that automation is happening on both the areas where machineries are getting more and more automated. I can tell you from our industry, with far more automation, the number of manpower required is far lesser. The quality standards have gone up. The hourly production has gone up multiple times. And all this has been possible with automation. Every time that we buy the new machinery, we find that the level of automation has gone up. The kind of quality checks that is there on the machine, the in ensuring that the product is defect-free, those standards are continuously going up and it does not require human interface, or the human interface is continuously going lesser and lesser. Similarly, on the software side, software is again helping bringing a lot of convenience and let's say ease of life for the consumers, whether these are taxi apps, whether, you know, there are endless examples where customers today want everything to be available to them at a click of a button. And that's going exactly, you know, so as Uday said, automation was happening for last 10, 15 years or even more, but it has really picked up in last 3-4 years, and COVID has actually added fuel to the fire where we cannot go out and therefore we want everything at our doorsteps, and automation is playing a very big role there.
Right, absolutely. So when we talk about automation, there is, you know, a common fear about people losing jobs because here machines are replacing humans. I want to know from you, are these fears justified?
As going forward, as I mentioned to you earlier, every factory in the world will be having very fewer people managing robots. And this is, you know, having a direct impact on labor policy and government, and people have to upskill them. So there's a lot of work, not just on the automation front, but also as companies, we need to see how we can upskill our current labor and, you know, use them effectively in more value-added jobs. So that's how the future of factories is going to be. And equipment automation will play a significant role. And today, if you look between Western countries and emerging markets, it's only the labor cost arbitrage. The more and more they will automate, that labor cost and that arbitrage will come lesser. So how are we going to, as a country like India, how are we going to, you know, face that challenge is where the big problem is. So if your factories are going to be heavily automized, I think the cost difference between Germany and India is today not much. So we need to up, there's a lot of work needs to be on the skill set of labor, as you said, to remove this fear.
Pankaj, you were saying something?
Yeah. So see, humankind has always been fearing that whether technology can replace jobs. And till now, the experience doesn't say this. The real life experiences, technology has created more jobs every time something new has come up, because customers are looking for convenience at the end of the day. They want better things, they want more things, and at a lesser cost all the time. And therefore, automation to that extent is not just cutting down cost, but improving convenience. In fact, I was just reading something a day back, and one of the critical studies was done. And they said one of the things where maximum innovation is going to happen is to improve customer convenience. So yes, in some areas, jobs will come down. In other areas, jobs will go up. But at the end of the day, what is very critical, as Kanish said, that we have to continuously upgrade the knowledge, the skill sets are people. And it's happening also. We cannot say that it's not happening. If we see the number of software engineers, which India used to produce 20 years back, and the number of software engineers which India produces today, the number has gone many fold. And if we see the kids today, they are far more educated. They start, learning new courses. The opportunities are much more. You know, earlier, a kid can go only to school to learn. But today there are so many applications which have come where a child can sit at home and learn. So, you know, what we are seeing is that newer things are coming, and at the same time, newer jobs are getting created because of technology, and customer wants to try different things. You know, they do not want to stuck up just with one thing. So if a child can do it, the adoption at every age group is definitely going up, and it will continue to go up. So one side, the labor-oriented jobs will have a challenge, and therefore, the knowledge upgradation, the skill set upgradation is extremely important. And India as a country need to do that faster and faster all the time, because we have a very big population. But I'm sure it will throw a lot of opportunities for people, and newer jobs will continue to get created.
Right. You very correctly pointed out about India being a skeptical economy when it comes to adopting technology. Very good point. Uday, would you like to add something to this conversation?
The Pankaj has put some very interesting points. And we you know, from our side, we run businesses, as I said, in the industrial side, in the infrastructure side, and obviously in the mobility side. What we have seen is, while we have kept our factories open right through the pandemic. We were involved in essential services. So it wasn't that we ever closed our factories. Even in this last month and a half, we've been out on the front lines. And the problem we're facing is worker shortages and supply chain disruptions are forcing that manufacturing sector to quickly go digital. So it's not that automation is leading to job losses. We're finding worker shortages in the short term. Obviously, the Indian manufacturing sector has slowly been transitioning to Industry 4.0. And this is very important to know over the last 2 years. Also, the COVID-19 pandemic is significantly accelerating this pace. Industry 4.0 is the new term, which we all widely use for what is seen as the fourth industrial revolution with the use of connectivity. IoT is very important. Advanced analytics, AI, and ML. The use of connectivity is, and all of this automation, robotics, advanced generation, 3D printing, non-particles, they said to bring companies increased efficiency and a high level of product, you know, customization. Improving speed is very important, creating totally new business models. So one thing that's clearly important, the takeaways are, even when the pandemic subsides, it will leave behind a changed economic landscape for manufacturers in their customers. There's a whole dynamic going on here, guys, that we see that, you know, people are thinking, when COVID goes, which God knows when it will go, we've got to learn to live with it. There'll be a less global, more local, presents opportunities for those that are able to adapt quickly. You know, we have a saying in our company, Change with the time, or time will change you. This is important for the labor. This is important for middle and senior management. And this is important for all owners. Focusing on automation and targeting areas of economy likely to grow and help companies succeed moving forward. When it comes to automation, it's extremely important that we all understand and upgrading our labor force. Look, I am not going to go to the government and cry, this is right, this is wrong. I'm going to do things which is going to be myself. I say, let's do for the country first and wait for the country to do later. So we're going to work in upgrading our entire labor force. And we're going to make sure they are trained. They are moving up the food chain and continually improve efficiency, productivity, and more income. Because if you give more income, they'll be able to be more healthy, which will be more productive.
Right, absolutely. And very correctly pointed out that entrepreneurs are the solution providers and the problem solvers. So they, I mean, we have to rely on the entrepreneurs of this country to spearhead every and trailblaze every new innovation, you know, in order to build an Atmanirbhar Bharat. So gentlemen, now we've established that automation is very important for the Indian business ecosystem. I want to ask that when it comes to SMBs automating their product lines, it also means huge investment, especially when this automation is robot-based. How can SMBs tackle this challenge when already they are facing so much of financial burden in the wake of the circumstances that have unraveled over the last 1 year?
Adding on to what Uday said, so the problem here is not labor, but the upskilling the labor to the previous question. So as an organization at Eki, what we have done is established a center of excellences in two engineering and one diploma college within our community space. So we go there and teach students and all the diploma guys to come and work in our factory and what we want. So kind of we give them the syllabus on what kind of job description, everything. So by the time that 4 years or 3 years, that graduate who's coming into our factory, he gets to know about the industry. And we are not just doing it alone. We are also partnering with similar water ecosystem companies like pipe companies, like other pump companies, like technology companies to do this upskilling. And when it comes to automation, yes, rightly said, there is a big cost involved in automation today. So you as a company have to identify which parts of the organization have to be automated first. In our company, for instance, we are automating heavily on the customer facing side because the customer is the key. So how can we make it easier for him? We serve around 100,000 farmers every year. For example, today our farmer does not need to go to the pump to switch on or off the pump. He can do it by the app that we have developed. So it is important for companies to choose which areas to automate first and put their investment in that direction. And primarily, we are doing it in the customer facing part.
Absolutely. Pankaj, Uday, what would you like to add?
So I will say that, you know, automation is adopted if there are multiple things which are being met. First is the person or the corporation which has to use the automation should be aware about it. Second thing is it has have value for money. And if there's no value for money, the corporations tend to stick to their old methods, and the day they see the value for money. And what we have clearly seen is that any technology adoption or automation adoption first happens with the larger companies who are very quick to respond to any new new way of doing things. Then the cost starts coming down. Then the middle-sized companies adopt it. The cost comes down further. And then ideally, the smaller companies should also adopt it. The challenge in India is that the larger companies and to a large extent, the middle-sized companies are adopting these innovations or automations. The problem really lies at the smaller company levels, one man, 10 people, 20 people, 30 people companies, which are not adopting it at, you know, at the speed at which it is required. And I think more knowledge has to be given to them that, look, now the technology cost has already come down so much that it's time for them to really adopt it. Because if they don't adopt it sooner than later, you know, they will not exist in the business. And I, you know, I have personally seen very small entrepreneurs which have stopped to exist because they were still, even like 5 years back, they were doing manual accounting, right? Which is quite unheard of. 30 years back, people used to hear manual accounting, but not in today's world. And, you know, with more and more automation happening. So I think the challenge really lies in the smallest strata of the country. The middle companies, middle-sized companies are mostly doing it. They also need to increase adoption more and more because technology is really spreading so fast. You see innovations happening every other day. It's very important to keep oneself updated in terms of what's going on. Many times, you know, when I personally see and try and Google something, some of the things that I thought that is not possible, you Google it and you find that there's an app or there's a product available to already service your need. So it's very important to, you know, continuously garner that knowledge, gain that knowledge in terms of what's going on and keep adopting it. And it will happen only if there's a value for money. And, you know, there's several examples. Solar is such a big example, which is not obviously automation. Solar used to be so much expensive 10 years back, and only the rich countries could afford it. Then we started seeing that the developing countries started adopting it because the cost of technology came down. And now we see even, you know, every household in even a underdeveloped country is trying to adopt solar because the cost of technology has really reached that level. So at the end of the day, technology has to have value for money. The sellers of technology need to make sure that it's available at the right price. And the consumers need to understand it, do their calculations, do their mathematics. But we have to also understand it's not just cost. It also improves quality. It improves productivity. It improves wastages. So you have to take care of all the things together to see what are the real benefits of it. Speed, again, is an important thing. So I feel that technology will continue to get adopted. Larger organizations, medium-sized organizations, smaller organizations also need to uplift themselves and make sure that they're able to adopt it.
Absolutely. Uday, would you like to say something to that?
Sure, I'll add. Look, upskilling is imperative. It is necessary. It will continually need that. Building a future-ready workforce for automation, that is critical. These are things that it is not even a, you know, there is no question to it. It's time for companies like ourselves and everybody around us, individuals, to embrace, you know, upskilling. It's imperative, as I've said. For companies, upskilling enables them to build a future for a ready workforce. For individuals, for example, that, you know, it's a way to keep their skills relevant, you know, and stay future ready themselves and for the companies. Making deliberate, significant investments in learning will ensure organizations and employees alike have the knowledge. The skills, you know, capabilities needed to work effectively in a digitized automated world. As automation and digitization disrupt industries in which they will and transform businesses, they're reshaping all the existing jobs that we get reshaped. Your job, my job, everybody's job is getting changed continuously. And we have to make sure that we continually upgrade our skills. Upskilling today workforce is extremely critical. I cannot emphasize more enough. And if companies are to harness the power of AI and capitalize on their talent and stay competitive and ensure India. See, the thing is, we talk about Atmanirbhar India. We need all this for Atmanirbhar India to be. See, the slogan bazi can continue, but the reality, the hard work needs to be done. It's very easy to make these, you know, Atmanirbhar India, make in India, local for vocal. But we've got to change. We've got to be able to feel that we are competitive with the Chinese or the Koreans or the Japanese. And how do we do that? Our labor force has to be upskilled. We, every one of us has to continually upskill. As we said, me and Mr. Porter are a bit older guys. We continuously, I'm 52, I got to continually upgrade myself every day. You know, so forget about the IIT graduates that come out. So this is clear for everybody in our industries.
Right. And, you know, if you can just hold on to that thought and also answer my next question. One of the common dilemmas that businesses face is how much or at what level they need to automate their product lines, because there are some robots or some machines that, you know, that work on a 24-hour basis. But, you know, the capability is not something what, you know, these small or medium sized businesses require. So, do they need to keep in mind anything specific while, you know, they are adopting or while they are automating their product lines, Uday?
Very good question again. look, despite the widespread adoption of robotic automation in some areas of manufacturing, more extensive use of robots is often slow. And you have to understand it's even blocked by inability to justify the upfront investment. So what happens is that we as a community, we as a group, we've got to continually make sure that investment has to continue to go in at a pace that is sort of capable of each organization. Not every organization can continually reinvest in a heavy way. It is a step-by-step approach. So for us, what needs to happen for everyone has to look at what are their capital outflows, and they have to plan accordingly. But if you close your eyes, it's like horses with blinders. If you keep blind, you'll be run out of business. So I think, you know, we've got to continually look at areas where we can reinvest in a phased manner. Every business should look at a 5-year plan or a 10-year plan and continually scale. Obviously, when you get the momentum, when you get the support, when you get the success, investments will continue to go. So I think this is a very important part that, you know, robotics, we have our industry, we have our companies where we are introducing it, but we cannot, because Indian consumers are very price sensitive, right? So if you invest heavily into robotics, your ROIs aren't coming back. And our small and medium-sized companies are even more sensitive to ROIs, right? So what we need to do is have a phased-in, skilled-in, you know, scaled-in approach and continue to grow. And I think the answer is clear. Automation has to happen, but it has to be in scaled manner.
Kanishka, would you like to add something?
The big problem is not losing jobs, but upskilling jobs. So as organizations, what we could do is what we all have to see. And I'm sure as long as the aspiration is there, definitely if it's small company or medium company or large company, there are means to it. And of course, like if you look, as I told you earlier, we've developed 3 skill centers within the water ecosystem and partnering with a lot of other companies to upskill the talent for our industry. I'm sure the software industry has done it long time ago, like the Infosys, TCS and Cognizant. They went to engineering colleges in India and gave them the syllabus and recruited them. So this will happen in manufacturing industries as well, and everybody must do it. As Uday said, like these are not something that you can't do. It is essential, it is coming, and it is going to change very rapidly. The change that happened in the last 100 years is happening within 1 year. So definitely people have to adapt, and those of them will adapt will survive, and those who do not adapt will die. So this is what's going to happen. And today, government is also helping us a lot. For example, the National Skill Development Corporation, there's a lot of funds like the GITA. The CII is working a lot with medium-sized and large companies, to put a framework and supporting the R&D. For example, the Ministry of Science and Technology is investing heavily in doing all this stuff. So the government support in India is also great. And as organizations, we also need to have that innovative open-mindedness. And open innovation is needed to partner with your other competitors or even your fellow industry members. So this is very key. And as long as the aspiration is there, I'm sure definitely we can upskill our labor and get ready for 4.0 and whatever you call it, you know, you call it 4.0, AI, ML. These are all only tools that are going to make your product and your company globally competitive. So it is essential for companies, whether you're in India or China or Taiwan, to be globally competitive. Your product and service have to be globally competitive, and this is the key. So the modern day customer, in short, I would always jokingly say, he wants a German engineering, Japanese quality, American marketing at Chinese price, probably combine it with India's hospitality and IT capabilities.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for pointing that out. Pankaj, when we talk about robots and robots are being used to clean rooms or as salespeople, they are already a reality in countries like Japan, Singapore, America. Do you see these things happening in India very soon at a larger scale than we've ever thought of?
So there has been an early adoption of these technologies too. However, given that manpower cost is so less in India versus these countries, and therefore many homes still use the traditional methods of home cleaning, But India, we have seen, has not been so much behind in terms of these technology adoptions. And as the country progresses, we do see that adoption is getting faster and faster. The other thing is that these kind of products, again, whether the consumer even knows about it. You know, I said that for technology adoption, one of the critical things is knowledge. And has any company still advertised in a bigger way that, look, this kind of technology is available? And I can tell you, this is very cheap. Huh? When I first looked at this product, this is available for a few thousand rupees. So I see many, many households can actually adopt this technology. They can continue their traditional methods, but this can definitely be an addition to their other automation tools. And if we make more and more customers aware about it, I feel the adoption for this can really increase manifold.
Absolutely. One last question before we share our final thoughts, and I'd like to bring in a conversation I was having with a robotics company that is based out of Singapore. So the founder told me this very interesting thing, that the Singapore government wants retail stores to include robots and is nowadays giving them 70% of subsidies to the companies for the same. While all of us are doers and, you know, Indian entrepreneurs are very strong, I want to know that what are some of the steps that Indian government or the industry bodies can take to encourage SMBs and, you know, businesses to adopt automation? We can start with Uday.
Sure. Look, you know, we work closely with companies. You know, you mentioned Japan, our automotive business, which has been around for 50 plus years. We've worked very closely. We supply to large Japanese players. And Singapore, we understand that. See, the thing is, Singapore, and I watched that area closely. I've spent a lot of time between Singapore and the Far East. The labor costs are very high and there's a shortage of labor. You know, it makes sense for them. Robotics is, you know, very important for them. India, whereas India is concerned, right? We need to do a cost-benefit analysis and see what are the areas where we need more efficiency, more quality, right? Every, you know, in England, we say different courses for different horses. We can't run every horse on the same course. So what works for Singapore, or what works for Japan, or works for Germany, doesn't really work. And believe you me, I have learned that lesson even more in the last 18 months. So the Indian government and the industry bodies obviously need to give incentives, give companies the benefit who are training workers in the area of automation. We do a lot of talk, but when it comes to doing the walk, it's very difficult, right? There has to be PPP where the government should be involved in vocational training programs to upskill the labor. If you look at Germany, if you look at other countries, we don't all need to be doctors or engineers. Some of the mechanics, some of the cooks, some of the others, it's very, you know, they have vocational training schools. So I think that mindset needs to change, that not everybody needs to be a doctor, lawyer, or has to be an engineer. There are many other jobs and we need to upskill, and vocational training is extremely important. In the years to come, the workers of the future should not be doing basic work. They should just know how to operate the machines to work for them. The machines should be doing the work. And if they know that, their wages will go up. If their wages will go up, their standard of living will go up, their health will go up, and the ecosystem will be better. And one last thing I'd like to say on this is, we as a community of businessmen are so used to it. Government kuch nahi karti hamare liye. Forget the government. Let's start doing it ourselves. So I would like every one of us to do more ourselves. And then if the government will do, it will do. Right? Let's do it ourselves. And that is for me, you know, for me, India first is what's important. And we all need to be part of it.
Right. Kanishka and Pankaj, if you can share very quickly your thoughts.
I agree with Uday. See, rather than just complaining what the government is going to do, example, let's say the government is going to give a tax incentive to put a particular factory in one region. And will you go and put a factory? No, you will check the labor availability, you will check the skill set availability, you will check the supplier availability. The whole infrastructure for your industry has to exist. Just not by government doing work, your suppliers, your labors, you have to upskill your team. the whole ecosystem has to be in a positive way for an industry to flourish, right from the supplier to the customer. So just by the asking the government alone to give incentives, I'm not a huge fan of incentivized plans where you just go put a plant or you do a business, just the government is giving a subsidy. So I'm not a huge fan of subsidies and incentives. But of course, the government is doing a lot of stuff on giving incentives for R&D, innovation, and upskilling. And I think we should all effectively utilize it and also fund partly from your industry and your ecosystem to do this in the right way. So I think it should be a joint effort rather than just asking, oh, the government has to look after everything, you know. This is what my opinion is.
Pankaj, your thoughts?
So few of the countries, you know, see, the first thing is that human being needs are continuously going up. They are going very, very fast. They see more technology, more automation, and their needs are ever increasing. The challenge with some of the countries is that their population is going down, and therefore those countries have to adopt technology at a much faster pace than the other countries. Fortunately, India is still not that not facing that problem. We still have an increasing population. For us, we have to also make sure that jobs are available for the entire population. So one side, upskilling is definitely very important at every corporation level. Having said that, we do not need to have the same pace of automation as developed countries. We have to see what makes sense for the country. And what is value for money? What is the cost-benefit analysis? And I think corporations in India will continue to follow the return on capital way of adopting technology.
Absolutely. So before we conclude, request everyone to share one line on how rise in the automation will really help the Indian manufacturing sector shine. So in one liner, if you can really sum up all the points and all the insights that you've shared up until now. We can start with Pankaj, followed by Uday and Kanishka.
Knowledge is power. First, ensure that you invest on ensuring you have enough knowledge, and then keep checking for value for money and adopt more and more technology in the company, more and more automation in the company.
Thank you. Uday?
For us, smart factories are the way forward, and combining data exchange with automation is the key for the goals to get factory 4.0. And one last thing, keep India first, all of us. That's most important.
I'd like to emphasize, as I told you earlier, modern day customer wants Japanese quality, German engineering, Italian finish, combined with India's IT capabilities at Chinese price. So you have to become globally competitive and focus on what the customer wants. So this is my takeaway.
Amazing. Great. Thank you so much, Uday. Thank you, Kanishka. Thank you, Pankaj, for joining us today and sharing for having such an insightful discussion on this topic. Thank you so much. We are very, very, very happy to have had this conversation with you. Before signing off, here's a special shout out to Lenovo and Intel, our title sponsors for the Indian MSME Summit 2021, and our co-sponsors, AWS and TransUnion Sybil. Their coming on board has helped us pull this event off with great glory and make it a success. Thank you.